So good morning, everybody. My topic is I'm going to talk about future trends in digital forensics and investigations. So this is the perspective. This is from the perspective of law enforcement, and also from the perspective of corporate investigators who are involved with, you know, digital forensic and online investigations and things like that. Okay, but before I begin, I'd like, you know, to talk about something else. You all heard of the Mausam Vibhag, the Indian Meteorological Department? If you have, please type a yes in the chat. Okay, excellent. Thank you. Now, essentially, you know that they're in the business of making predictions about the weather. And they have been predicting, you know, the monsoons in Delhi from the 11th of June. And then it got postponed to 13th of June, 14th of June, 18th of June. And, you know, it has been postponed, I think, 6, 7, 8 times their predictions. And ultimately, you know, now they're saying by the end of this month, the monsoons are going to come. So the point I'm trying to emphasize is that making predictions about the future is, you know, a very difficult business. So any predictions I make may or may not come true going forward, but I'd like you to bear with me. So if I have your permission, I would like to, you know, continue and try and present my views on what the future holds for the digital forensics and investigations area. I hope that's acceptable. Is that okay? Please say yes.
Yes, sir.
Good. All right, so let's get started. There's a little bit about me. They've already, you know, talked about me, so I'll carry on. A quick look at into the future. Okay, so let's take a look at the future. You know, we all know that, you know, CCTV is going to be big. So everywhere there are going to be CCTVs, there are going to be cameras everywhere. We are beginning to see the trend, and this is going to increase. In fact, you know, in countries like the UK, there is one CCTV camera, or rather there are three CCTV cameras per person, depending on whichever, you know, areas you are in certain places. So the huge volume of CCTV cameras, the CCTV footage, the data produced by CCTVs is going to grow. So CCTVs are going to be very big. That's one of my, predictions, you can say. Which means that we are going to face a lot of trouble with videos, with images, with, you know, data storage related to cameras and things like that. Because what is going to happen is that in a very large number of cases, we have situations where the quality of data is extremely poor. You have blurry images, you have shaky images, you have dark images, you have, you know, images taken at an angle, because you place a CCTV and you don't know how people are going to, you know, stand and focus in connection to that. So technology to solve those kind of problems has to advance, has to improve, has to increase. Then images and videos are being already manipulated very easily. Dr. Gaurav talked about the, you know, fake, deep fakes and things like that. In fact, you know, here we have four examples of President Obama. And if you take a close look, I'm sure you all feel that you can identify that one of them is a fake. But actually, the real fact about this is that all four of them are fake. So the key here is that for us, we must understand that deep fakes and fakes are coming and are here to stay. So it's going to be very difficult to depend on digital video evidence or digital images as evidence, because unless the authenticity can be verified, there is no surety that this is the genuine thing. So we will need to separate the real from the fakes. Privacy will be big. And passwords will be strong. Everyone is now, you know, beginning to become aware that, look, we need to build stronger passwords. We must use passphrases instead of passwords. The password should be, you know, longer than 8 characters. It should have an uppercase, it should have a lowercase, it should have a special character, it should have numbers. So we are all, you know, thinking along those lines. So for us, it's extremely important that, you know, passwords be strong. So similarly, you know, all criminals, nobody wants to get caught, and they're all going to insist on having complex encryption methodologies and complex and difficult to crack passwords using brute force. So we will need to have enhanced password and decryption cracking technologies that will have to be able to take care of things like that. Quantum technologies is an example of that. Personal devices are crucial. I remember, you know, in the late 90s when mobile phones came to India and I would be delivering talks at various, you know, police academies, I would ask people, how many of you have mobile phones? And I would get an answer, you know, one or two would raise their hand and say, yes, I have a mobile phone. Very interestingly, you know, just within 6 months, the scenario changed. And when I would ask, how many of you have a mobile phone? Everybody would raise their hand except one or two. So I had to change my question. I changed my question to ask, how many of you don't have a mobile phone? Today, my question has changed again. These days, I ask, how many of you have less than 2 mobile phones or 2 SIMs? So that is the situation now. That personal devices are crucial. We live by our devices. In fact, a lot of us have stopped using computers altogether. You know, if we have a tablet or we have a phone with a decent screen size, we tend to try and do everything on it. We play games on it. We, you know, make movies and videos on it. We communicate using it. We send emails using it. Our social media lives are on this. So there's a lot of things happening. Our financials, our banking, our communication with friends and family, everything is from the mobile phone. Which means that the mobile phones are a treasure trove of data, and from an investigation perspective, their cruciality, their criticality is increasing. And our ability to get the data from them is even more crucial. Now, the trouble with mobile phones is that they're getting complex. And with, you know, this current focus on avoiding less made in China and moving to things like make in India, we are finding that more and more electronic devices and equipments are being manufactured in India. So going forward, you're going to find a lot of phones coming out of India. And they're not only going to be available in India, they're also going to be sold in different parts of the world. In fact, a lot of Indian products are going out. And, you know, as a China plus one supplier, a lot of countries are exploring buying from India and setting up manufacturing facilities in India. Apple is an example. So based on that, we're going to see a lot more India-specific phones, India-specific devices, India-manufactured products which are electronic in nature. And again, the foreign forensic tool companies may not be able to cope with this. So only those companies out there which are going to be able to handle data which is from Indian devices is going to be very successful. In fact, I think we have one of the speakers, a good friend of mine, Dusan, who will be speaking. He's from Compulson or Mobile Edit, and they're doing a lot of Indian devices these days. So what happens is that we have to now gear up to be able to handle situations where we can handle data from a multitude of sources such as this. Then, you know, we've heard that, you know, every investigation involves two kinds of sources of evidence. One is, of course, the CDR, and the second is the video evidence. So my prediction is that CDR analysis is dead. CDR analysis is a commodity. It is now, you know, something that everybody does, and every criminal also knows that. So the IPDR analysis is the next big thing when it comes to, you know, telephone call log analysis, because a lot of activities done by phones without the knowledge of the phone owner. In fact, there is a lot of system data and system pinging that is going on, and that gives an indication, at least definitely about the location, definitely about the apps that are installed, definitely about, you know, the activities a person is doing on the phone, and, you know, active use of voice over IP, communication between multiple people and things like that. So as they say, you know, the king is dead, long live the king. So the king of investigations was CDR analysis, and my prediction is that CDR analysis is dead. IPDR is the next big thing. It's a digital age. The police has to be digital. We have to be, you know, extremely technology oriented. We need to be able to connect with, correlate, collate, and understand linkages between information from multitude of sources and multitude of databases that exist and will begin to exist coming in the future. So we have to be digital. There are certain trends that we are seeing. In fact, there was a report by Variant Market Research called Global Digital Forensics Market. And here, you know, what they've said is that the digital forensics market is going to go up to a $7 billion size by 2025. That is 4 years from now. The global digital forensics market is going to be 7 billion. So this is a huge growth area. In fact, you know, more and more companies and consumers rely on connected devices. We all know, you know, each one of us owns 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 devices. So we have so many things. We have a mobile phone, we have a 2 mobile phones, we have a tablet, we have a computer, a laptop, a digital TV, we have Alexa, we have, all sorts of things. So all of these are connected to the internet. You know, we have CCTV cameras, which you can access using your phone over the internet and things like that. So we are living in a world of connected devices, and the prospect of becoming a victim of cybercrime has also increased a lot. And as the technology price goes down, what happens is that technology becomes more widely available and cybercrime also increases. And that creates more challenges for all security practitioners. But there are certain emerging technologies that can help digital forensic investigators. So let's just do a little talk about the emerging technologies that are there. Now, new tools keep coming. You know, people keep developing new tools that might be useful from a forensic investigation perspective. See, many of these tools are only starting to take shape, and others are already ready and they're being tested in the real world. In fact, our company works in the area of forensic tools, and we are also heavily involved in, you know, working and developing in these tools, and also working with a lot of international companies in this area. Then some of these emerging technologies include artificial intelligence, Li-Fi, machine vision. These are big and they're growing bigger. Some of the challenges, like I mentioned, increase of digital devices, extensive use of the internet. And, you know, we've also had certain other challenges. Like, we've had a very interesting case. How many of you have heard of Net4India? Please type yes if you've heard of Net4India. Right. So, you know, Net4India, thank you. Net4India is a registrar, or rather, I have to say it was a registrar, which is based in India. And it was the domain registrar for a lot of domains that were registered by Indians. Now, that registrar has collapsed, which is a very serious thing. And because it has collapsed, you know, these domains have been given by ICANN and other these things to a lot of other registrars across the world, you know. So this creates a bit of a nightmare for the community. Because when you are entrusting your digital resources to the custodians such as domain name registrars, so then what happens is that these domain name registrars, when they go out of business, you are, you know, concerned about your property, and if it gets misappropriated by criminals, it can be misused. So it's a big problem. Hacking tools are easily available. A lot of them are free. There are cracked versions also available out there. And, you know, from a criminal perspective, it is a gold mine, you know. You just have to go out there and get it. Lack of physical evidence, big problem. And the amount of storage space that is required is huge. That is into terabytes. And that makes investigations job very difficult. In fact, from a police perspective, just buying the necessary storage is a big problem for the police. So it's an issue. So a lot of technological changes are required to constantly upgrade and to, you know, keep up with changes to solutions. A lot of, you know, constant development is happening. New devices keep coming up. So new development happens. Upgradations are required on an ongoing basis. In fact, you know, there are hard drives now which are available up to 20 terabyte a drive. So it is huge. Solid state drives, the cost has reduced a lot. Size has gone up. There are hybrid drives available. Large and cheap storage and cloud storage is available. And cloud storage is another area, you know, which is now for an investigator, an area of concern, because the cloud data is spread over multitude servers, multitude jurisdictions, and they're spread over multitude, companies as well. So a lot of times, there are virtual cloud service providers who actually buy their storage from somebody else. So from an investigation perspective, again, that is an area of challenge. Time is always a bottleneck. Data sets may grow, but the time to do that work is actually reducing because the number of cases has grown, the backlog has gone up. So there's a constant pressure to finish cases fast. So we need to be able to handle this really fast. Processing of the data has to happen fast. The reviewing of the data has to, you know, happen faster. So we have to do this quicker and keep doing it. That means more artifacts, more data, more artifacts, more time required. More sources of data, desktops, laptops, smartphones, tablets, social media, cloud storage, IoTs, more time to process. Again, growing data sets, larger hard drives, cloud storage, again, needs more time to process. So what we need is the need for speed. So why can't we process faster? Where are the bottlenecks? You know, IO speeds are the bottlenecks. Read, write to a disk is slow, even on RAIDs. I mean, take the example of this, of a famous forensic tool, you know, the FTK. FTK works extensively by reading and writing on the hard disk, and it does a lot of indexing. And it takes a lot of time. It can take 24 hours to index a hard disk. Why? Because reading and writing limitation is from the hard disk side. So even if you have RAIDs and things like that, unless your cases are small, you can, you know, get this fast and do it. But with good hardware, things happen. So it's just a matter of doing things in a systematic manner. Again, processing power per PC, per server is reduced. Now, is less. What we need is a much higher capability from the computing perspective. And then the old inefficient style of data analysis and review is also an issue. So even on RAIDs, read writes are slow. So one can use multiple storage disks in parallel. You could have RAIDs, you could have SSDs. You have, 100 hard disks working at 10 gigabytes per second, which is useful. You can have multiple high-end forensic workstations. You can have multiple, you should definitely have them with SSDs. And if you have SSD RAIDs, even better. You can have parallel clustered file systems distributed, etc. And all these are ways to increase your speed. Similarly, this is a BGFS layout, an example, Lustre clustered file system. Then processing power, you can go for distributed processing. Everybody's heard of Hadoop. You can distribute work across a cluster of machines, have a shared file system, and the work is distributed, makes life easier. Then there is the old and inefficient style of data analysis and review. So you can, actually get into analysis and review on a more focused basis. Suppose, I'm just looking at cases of exfiltration. So I might want to just focus on exfiltration rather than, looking at everything. Because with time limitations and things like that, in a corporate environment, I may not want to go in for every minor aspect so that, I have to focus on getting all the data. So if I'm focused on what I want, I can focus on just that. So again, these are things that we have to, analyze our analytical focus and then take a decision on that. So we need to be looking at new methods of doing things. Then we need to have centralized methods of reviewing data. We have data from multiple sources. We need to be able to ingest, you know, mobile phone data, you know, tablets data, data from cloud, from computer artifacts, from incident response logs, from IoT devices, from, you know, different probes and sensors that are out there, which are actually giving us inputs 24/7. And all that data needs to be brought in, collated, correlated, and analyzed to arrive at some kind of, combined and coherent picture, which makes sense to the investigator. We need to, you know, look at improved speed. We need to look at centralized review, and we need to use extensive machine learning and artificial intelligence to actually, you know, speed up our analysis process. So we all know, you know, artificial intelligence is increasing day by day. Machine learning is one of the biggies. It's a lot of things are happening. And there are intelligent agents that are used to do this. So in forensics, we have intelligent agents, and their purpose is, you know, that it can speed up processes and move things really, really fast. So you could actually have hash set agents, you could have file path agents, file signature agents, timeline agents, registry agents, keyword agents, all different types of agents with, you know, specific directed tasks whose specific role is to work in that area. This, and these are great areas for researchers to work in. It is, you know, great areas to start new product companies, you know, to develop solutions for the future. So all of you who have this kind of capability and ability, who are, you know, doing great things in, using coding and programming and things like that, great opportunity for you all. For all those in the academic areas, you know, opportunity to do research, opportunity to develop capabilities and knowledge in these areas. Then, you know, the ability to handle large repositories of data in a short period of time is something that you should be looking at. So, for example, you know, looking through video evidence is such a big problem. There's so much of it. If I have to go through, a 1,000 terabytes or 100 terabytes of video evidence that I've collected in a smart city to identify, you know, one red car with a number plate ending in 26, it will take me years. But if I have the right kind of technology, you know, using things like artificial intelligence, I will be able to get that data, and I will be able to arrive at a quick solution to the problem. So, artificial intelligence can analyze this data at a much faster rate by comparing the digital evidence against a predetermined set of criteria which we have set. So, machine learning is amazing, you know, but it has a lot of mistakes, and it requires data sets to learn from and things like that. So it takes time to develop your model. So these are processes that have to be started, that have to be refined, data sets have to be built. And these are areas in which, you know, there is a lot of opportunity for people, for students, for researchers, for organizations, for companies. These are areas one should be looking at. There are a lot of challenges in standardization. There is, you know, no universal standard when it comes to digital evidence collection. There is continuous changes in the technology, and traditional crimes are also gaining the benefits of this technology. So if we are using artificial intelligence to catch criminals also have access to the same technologies to, say, you know, scan millions of computers, look for open ports, and then, you know, carry out different kinds of activities using AI. So, and machine learning. So, one should be aware of all that as well. So, when it comes to, from a forensics perspective, we need to have data availability to support the modeling. I don't think that should be a problem, because from a forensic perspective, there are huge repositories of data available with the Indian policing environment and with the different government bodies for cases and data, and all that can be used to do the modeling. You know, there's probably got to be a private and public partnership in this. Similarly, there has to be well-scoped problems and methodologies that need to be developed. We need to explain the reasoning process, structure the representation of knowledge, have a well-organized evaluation criteria, and we need to integrate with current architecture, tools, and applications. And of course, Then there is Chappie. A lot of you may have seen this movie. This is about a robot which is used for law enforcement in South Africa, and then ultimately the robot goes rogue and it develops a consciousness and things like that. So when it comes to artificial intelligence, we will need to be able to carry out forensics of devices such as this. In fact, these things are happening right now today. We have open source artificial intelligence powered prosthetic legs. Now, if somebody goes and kicks somebody and he says, you know, his leg was taken over, or his leg was artificial intelligence, it used its own brain and kicked him. How can you answer that? So to prevent this GPL, you have to have the right kind of technology to be able to analyze it. So there are a lot of new directions, new futures, new activities. How much time do I have left?
Say you can continue up to 10-15 minutes more.
Oh, okay, perfect. Good. So again, you know, we are constantly actually depending on communication networks today. So there are new directions that we must look at. So we look at communication networks, mobile appliances. You know, we have these connected fridges, we have these connected TVs, we have these lights. You know, I can switch on and switch off my lights from, you know, 5 kilometers away or wherever, using my internet and things like that. So all of these are actually connected to the network. There is somewhere, you know, something happening. They're interacting. And that information itself is, forensic worthy. We are also moving, you know, beyond just analyzing hard disk images. Hard disk images are good, but, you know, we have to move beyond that. Memory forensics is something that is happening right now. Live system investigation methodologies are being developed. And they are not only in terms of research, but there are specific forensic tools available these days right away for live investigation. And it is also gaining more acceptability, you know, because of the sheer volume of data. I remember there was a case where, you know, we were asked to investigate one particular server, which was part of a very huge money laundering operation, you know, which was being run out of the British Cayman Islands. And we went and raided one call center where the server was set up for this money laundering. And when we landed there, you know, we said, we have come to seize your server. And those people, they looked at us and they, you know, smiled to each other and said, where is your truck? That server was huge. It was really humongous. And we would actually have not needed one truck. We would have probably needed two to be able to carry the whole server. It was the size of a whole room, you know. So the thing is that you are not the traditional disk forensics, which we think of as a investigation method, is slowly, you know, reducing. And we are, you know, coming to the stage where we are moving to a live system investigation methodology, where we can actually go in, seize the data we need, seize the areas we need, and just, you know, move out with that. We are not just restricted to the hard drive images and things. So that's just an example. Then, you know, another, you know, area where research should be focused on is definitely standard methodology for these kind of new investigation methods that are coming in. We need to make the digital forensic processes accurate, robust, and efficient. Now, by default, there are 4 steps in the process. We have acquisition, we have identification, we have evaluation, and then we have admission. So, you know, basically our reports which go into court. Again, there have been numerous process models, and there are, you know, different steps involved in the case of identifying, acquiring, analyzing, storage, reporting on the evidence. So there are more sophisticated models people are working on. You know, in fact, I've written a book called, Understanding or Learning Network Forensics, that's been published by PAC Publishers in the UK. There, you know, I have proposed a model called the TARA model. So one can have a look at that as well. Now, when it comes to cloud evidence, we need to be able to handle cloud data in a better manner, because the way the cloud data exists, what happens is that for us, it is extremely difficult to understand where it comes from. So most of the cloud data acquisition is what I would call as a logical acquisition. What we are trying to do is that we are trying to get the data that exists on the cloud, in a form which is more related to the artifacts that exist related to the activity. So there's going to be logs, there's going to be operating system artifacts, there's going to be the actual activities that have happened out there. There's going to be the artifacts created by the applications that we are using, and a lot of other things, But again, the actual physical seizure of the media is something that you're not going to be looking at, So we have to cater to that. And we also need to understand that that physical media may actually have more than one particular targets or persons of interest data. And there may be multiple systems that are, working there at the same time. And there could be virtual machines that are running and things like that. So, this is a totally different animal altogether. Then we need to be looking at, media forensics. There are... indexing is going to be crazy. Everybody's moving to video. The size of videos keeps going up. The amount of storage of video is like huge. In fact, I don't know how many terabytes of video are uploaded every second. I read somewhere, but I don't remember the exact number, So encryption is another area. Encryption is a pain point. There are full disk encryption is a big issue. Ransomware encryption is a big issue. We are all facing that. We are all, coming across it on a daily basis. For us, cracking encryption is a priority, or bypassing encryption is a priority. And that is where, sometimes all these gray 0 days that are out there are actually very useful to the forensic industry. In fact, the forensic industry dreads when there is something new happening, because what happens is that every time, Windows changes its version, it will add something new, and all the artifacts that we used to retrieve in a particular way are no longer accessible in that way. I mean, they change the methodology, they change the way it is stored, they change the, structure of the data and things like that. And it creates a nightmare for the investigator. Luckily, now that Windows 11 is coming, at least in the initial release, there are no major changes from a forensic point of view, as per my understanding. We'll see. Now, email investigations are also increasing a lot. But what we are now beginning to see is that emails are being supplanted by the, instant chat systems. So, you'll have things like Slack, you'll have things like WhatsApp is a, good private chat example, where, WhatsApp, Telegram and all, they're going crazy. The amount of and the volumes of data that exist are huge. And for us to be able to mine that data, to make sense of that data, to build timelines out of that data is a humongous task. It is very, very big. So these are things that one has to look at. You need to be able to support, smartphones and tablets. In fact, the best of mobile forensic tools, on a standalone basis, really don't do all the tools that are out there. So in fact, you need to buy, two, three tools at the same time to be sure of covering maybe, even 70 or 80% of all the phones that are out there. So these are some of the things that we need to look at, In fact, when we look at computers, the number of operating systems are a lot less. If we look at mobile phones, the number of operating systems are really, really huge. So again, these are areas of concern. There is now what is happening is that mobile phone devices are showing the trend of using systems on chip. Everything is on the chip. Storage is on the chip. And in fact, on certain mobiles, we are finding there's huge amounts of storage. So, investigating over the network, suppose I have a mobile which is say, sitting in Sao Paulo and I am, sitting in New Delhi and I need to access that mobile phone. I want to, go over the wire, over the network and, create an image or bring in an image. That mobile may have actually over 500 gigabytes of data. So for me, unless my bandwidth is something amazing, that is going to take a while. So again, these are issues that one needs to consider, you know, and keep these in mind. So of course, everything is evolving. Bandwidth is improving. Data throughput is improving. Technology, remote acquisition is also, you know, increasing and getting better. But these are things that are going to happen. So there are advances in technologies. There are advances in circuitry. There is advances in electronic design. You know, and cloud memory is huge. External memory support is going to become huge. So these kind of things are areas where we can actually look at and expect further developments. So tomorrow, you know, I want to, you know, get data off my iPhone, which I'm not using regularly, but I want to store it as a backup. I should be able to just put my iPhone in my docking cradle, and the data is transferred to either my laptop or somewhere else, you know, automatically. I shouldn't require me to, you know, do many things. And this is already in a number of ways, yes, possible, but the syncing of the phone should happen instantaneously and constantly, maybe perhaps when it is charging and things like that. JTAG and chip-off forensics is something that is good to an extent. What is happening is that, you know, we are acquiring JTAG and chip-off capabilities. We access our devices using the JTAG interface, and we are able to, you know, use ISP and things like that to connect to the devices and extract the data. But when the data is extracted, what is happening is that the contents of the data may come to us in an encrypted form, because phones are also, you know, taking the privacy thing to the next level. What they're doing is that they are upgrading the data. They are encrypting the data and storing it on the phone. So for us, even though we are acquiring the data from the chip, we are actually getting an encrypted form. So this is whole disk encryption, which is, you know, a nightmare from an investigator's point of view. Again, these are things that we have to solve. This could be, you know, encryption could be pre-activated by the manufacturer or enabled by the user. And when we do a JTAG acquisition, we are going to get this encrypted image. And if we want to decrypt it, then we are going to need the phone's higher level API. We are going to need the correct password or the fingerprint or the face scan or whatever we like, you know. So there are a lot of, you know, tools out there which help you. The specialized hardware is required if you want to extract, these JTAG and ISP and other extractions, chip-offs. Specialized hardware is required to be able to do that, and then you can get the data out. Network forensics, you know, why do we do it? Network forensics basically helps extensively from a chronology perspective. We are looking at a timeline of events. How did it happen? When did it happen? What happened first? What happened next? What happened after that? And so on and so forth. So, you know, these are things that we have to look at. And this is an essential aim, you know, of the investigator. Then we need to figure out what happened to the data. You know, what happens is that data is normally exfiltrated out of the system. Now, exfiltration of a small amount of data is something that is not that complex. But when it comes to large amounts of data, which could be terabytes, that exfiltration is going to be detected by the system. So there are, you know, methods, techniques of, you know, staggering the exfiltration and, you know, sort of merging it with data that is leaving the network in a manner which is, you know, sort of more in sync, so that your systems that are out there, your CMs that are out there, they do not detect the data movement leaving the network as anomalous. But what has happened is that the data still left the network. So we need to be able to identify how the data leaves the network, and, you know, how one can identify that this is the data that has gone, because we want to know what has left the network. Then we want to, you know, ensure that what went wrong that it could leave the network. And then once we have figured out what went wrong, we need to be able to fix it or patch it. So there are so many things that are happening, you know. So this is very complex. And the data could be in raw format. It could be something that humans don't understand, which, you know, machines find difficult to understand, especially your interception devices and things like that. So a lot of things. Then there is IoT. Okay, so in fact, IoT is an area which is what I would call a soft target. For everybody, you know, it is easy to hit something with which uses default passwords. A lot of people use default passwords on their IoT devices, and this is something that a lot of people will go for. IoT has actually multiple places where their evidence is stored. There's some on the cloud, there's some on the network, and there's some on the device. So forensics, again, is something that you will have to do at multiple levels. You'll have to do, you know, forensics on the cloud, forensics on the network, forensics on the IoT level devices. So that is, you know, some of the trends that you're going to see. And we all know why we need IoT. In fact, you know, the Mirai botnet is an example of, attack using IoT devices. And I mean, there's lots of stuff. There's cloud computing. Let me quickly talk about cloud computing. I'm coming to the end of my presentation, so I think, you know, I've also run out of time. I'm going to keep it short. So cloud computing, everything is there on the cloud these days. There are applications, mobile storage, databases, there are servers. There's a lot of stuff on the cloud, and it is increasing. It is not reducing. So the amount of data that is out there is huge. And we need to be able to access that, analyze it, timeline it, and, you know, get evidence which is admissible. So there's a lot of things that are happening, and we need to work on that area. And that brings me to the end of my presentation. If anybody wants a copy of my presentation, please hit this link and you'll get it. It is bit.ly/ppt-request. And that's it. Thank you very much. Be in touch.